Welcome back to Just Books. What's doing brisk business in the bookshops and who's shaking the bestseller charts? Here's a look.
An atmospheric first novel about love and death set in contemporary Goa. Densely structured fiction that shifts between Kalimpong and Manhattan with ease. A gripping account of an escaped Australian convict among Mumbai's lowlifers. A laudable translation of the well-known Hindi writer's landmark work, Kitne Pakistan. And at number one, Upamanyu Chatterjee's fourth novel is a characteristic blend of black humor and sexual comedy. At number five in the non-fiction list, Vikram Seth's family biography set in times of war and peace. A new book on Mother Teresa for children as well as adults. The best-selling collection of essays of compelling range and depth from the Nobel laureate. Gladwell's Blink takes a close look at split-second decisions and the power of the hunch. And at number one, an ode to mother love.
And here are five of my personal favorites of the week.
A lively and literate new history of the Pink City. Kamleshwar's famous Hindi novel, now out in a readable English translation. Stories from troubled Nagaland of a state wrecked by violence and militancy. A new series in which famous writers explore classical myths. The Nobel laureate's collection of best-selling essays, now out in an inexpensive paperback.
Neelam Sarangod teaches English literature at Allahabad University, but her latest book of fiction, Sikandar Chokpath, imaginatively captures some of the characters and stories that make up the city of the Sangam. Coming up, Neelam Sarangod, right after the break. Stay with Just Books.
These characters, these 11 survivors and the journalist who investigates their stories really are great characters, from an Anglo-Indian widow to a professor of English to...
Yes, there are representatives of all the cultures which surround us in Allahabad. So Allahabad is a city of overlapping cultures. And I hadn't yet thought of them as individuals. But then I began wondering about the politics of these people, and one thing I was sure of, these were people who had no active connection with politics. They were not the people who made decisions, but they were the victims, and they would never be remembered. No history book would have their names. Even some of them could not be identified. And it seemed to me that these mute characters needed somebody to voice their lives. I tried to iron out everything that was exceptional and focus on all that was ordinary. And that is why I deliberately chose representatives of the Muslim community, a representative of the Christian community, a representative of the Dalit community. There were die-hard Hindus, there were liberal Hindus. So this was supposed to be a cross-section of humanity in Allahabad. And eventually they share the same fate. So
you speak of the culture of Allahabad, this very ancient city, part of sacred geography, really.
Yes.
City of the Sangam, city of the Mughal emperors, Akbar's fort. City of high learning, one of the earliest high courts in India. What is this unique synthesis that Allahabad used to represent and in some ways has mutated or declined?
There have been many Allahabads in history. There have been multiple Allahabads. And they seem to belong to all the different chapters of Indian history that we read in our history books. There is a Hindu Allahabad. There is an Islamic Allahabad, there was a British Allahabad, and there is a modern Allahabad, and very, very sadly, a postmodern Allahabad.
What is so sad about postmodern Allahabad? Why is it a city, why is this great city declined, and in fact, gone out, fallen off the radar of most people?
What I find most disturbing is the lack of coherence about the way a city imagines itself. A loss of character and a kind of a waiting for some fresh character to emerge. But it is a city right now groping for an identity, and perhaps has already acquired the identity, but I am too close to it in history to be able to really pin it down.
Allahabad also has a, or had, a very powerful intellectual tradition. Some of the great poets, scholars, I'm thinking of Harivansh Rai Bachchan, yes. Virag Gorakhpuri, yes. Mahadevi Verma, come from Allahabad, taught there at the same university. Are you then arguing that the intellectual life of Allahabad has really fled the city?
I wouldn't say that. I really wouldn't say that. There continue to be writers. But their scale is somewhat diminished. And they share the fate of the city in the sense that a certain respectability label has in a way been withdrawn by mainstream literature from the city. So Allahabad is a city which inhabits the memories of writers, Nirmal Verma to remember Allahabad, you know. So it is a city which is a space in the literary memory. Whether it is a city out there in physical space which is worthy of fostering a literary tradition remains to be seen.
Yes, but when you speak of Allahabad today, all people seem to think is that the city of Amitabh Bachchan,
yes,
and of Mohammad Kayyam, not of the great Jawaharlal Nehru and Motilal Nehru.
I often have to remind people that, and I am grateful to Amitabh Bachchan for at least retaining us on the map. It is to be regretted, but perhaps not so much to be regretted, because we seem to be a city passing through a renaissance, and we are reinventing ourselves. There are many Allahabads. I have found Allahabad in Dehradun, I have found Allahabad in Lucknow. I find a pocket of Allahabad in Delhi, and I identify the traits of Allahabad in so many scattered places of the globe.
Allahabad University is one of the oldest in the country.
Yes.
A very, very strong department of literature. Mm. But what is it like teaching literature in a provincial town today? Who are your students and what are they looking for? A degree, a language, learning?
I feel privileged teaching English literature. And I can place myself in the situation of my students. I know it is not learning they are after. It is a kind of psychological empowerment, because Allahabad retains certain colonial hangovers. And for them, it is the assurance of having arrived somewhere. English continues to be a symbol of power. And as for me as a teacher, I do not distinguish between languages. I'm trying to teach them the essence, the content of whatever is assigned to me.
But is English their first language? Or do you translate?
Absolutely
freely
not.
From
I translate freely from Hindi. I have taught Shakespeare in Hindi. I have taught Milton in Hindi. I teach Dryden and Pope in Hindi. And I no longer have any kind of prejudice against teaching one literature in another language, so long as it remains an unforgettable experience for the students.
Instead, like a true teacher. Neelam, you have yourself not just written one, but several novels and collections of short stories. Do these come as part of your deep passion for teaching and loving English literature, or do they emerge out of your own culture and that of Allahabad and experience?
No, I will make an unworthy confession. Teaching is only my profession. I always wanted to write and only to write, and some merciful fate got me a teaching job. And when I found myself in this job, I have my life neatly apportioned between my professional obligations and between my personal passion, which was writing. So since I find myself a teacher, I do the best I can.
One of the great